Welcome, everybody. I'm really glad that you made it here, even after the banquet, and so late in the summer school. So yes, this talk, this lecture, is a bit of an experiment for myself, even, because I've never give a presentation like that or a lecture like that. But I thought it would be really worth it. And let me just, as an introduction, briefly say some words why I eventually decided or thought it was fun to do this type of lecture. So instead of focusing on just reinforcement learning itself, I would like to try to emphasize... Is your mic on? I didn't say anything important yet, so, okay. Instead of focusing on just a single topic like RL, I thought I'd try, and it's an experiment, as I said, to sort of emphasize that a whole bunch of problems and problem settings, Bannon's, active learning, Bayesian reinforcement learning, and also global optimization, are actually one thing conceptually. So I actually think of them as just being basically one type of problem. And I had the impression that this has not really been taught much in lectures or tutorials I looked through. And there is very good tutorials on all kinds of things. There is good tutorials on active learning. I'm going to cite it later. There is tutorials on reinforcement learning, of course, on optimization as well. But in these tutorials, they never really draw these connections. And they also do not frame these problems under the same formulation. And that's why I thought that while there are so much resources, like textbooks and tutorials on these specific topics, I try to sort of give this overview. This tutorial is technically not so difficult, I think, which is good for you after two weeks of summer school, right? So it's actually simple. So the message that I'm going to say is rather simple. So all of these problems can be viewed under one perspective, which is very much... like the perspective that eventually they end up being Markov processes in some belief space. And that is sort of trivial, but I think it's really worth to actually make this explicit and show these equations and then also draw some conclusions from that. Within this tutorial, we will also talk about what is optimal optimization, so the optimal optimizer, or what is optimal active learning and these kinds of things. And just as a disclaimer, whenever I say optimal, because all my frameworks will be assuming priors, so I actually mean base optimal, right? So in my formulations, I will always assume priors. So when I say optimal, I mean just base optimal. And as an outline, so what I will try to cover is, well, as the title mentions, these kinds of things. And in this order, I will first introduce the problem setting of Bandits, then of global optimization, then of active learning, then of Bayesian reinforcement learning, and very briefly also of PomDPs, because all of these can be viewed as PomDPs, just for completion in a sense. And while covering those, on the one hand, I will try to formulate them, you know, as Markov processes in belief space, but at the same time then cover these types of heuristics that are actually dominant within the research of these fields. So the kind of methods that would usually be introduced in tutorials on these kind of topics would be upper confidence bound or expected improvement, probability of improvement for optimization, or predictive error for active learning, and so forth. And I will discuss them as kind of well, heuristics or one-step heuristics, which are, you know, complementary to doing proper or exact belief planning to get optimal solutions. So in the end, I will also, you know, add a little discussion about this general, you know, issue of doing exact belief planning versus thinking and being creative about designing greedy heuristics. Okay, so let me start with the first part, with Bandits. So Bandits is well. I will later explain why I think it's really an archetype of all of these problems. Bandits is a type of problem which involves, well, on the one hand, choosing actions to learn, and on the other hand, choosing actions to get reward or get some return. So what are Bandits? Multi-arm Bandits are the case where you have n machines. So these are slot machines. You could think of these as slot machines. And it's a sequential process where in each stage, the agent is allowed to choose one of these machines and pull its lever. And when it chooses a machine in each iteration, the machine actually defines a probability distribution over returns. So y is a return, it's a scalar, a real number. And so when you pull a machine, you get a reward or a return, a y, which is sampled from some distribution. Well, the machine has some parameters, which I call theta I here. And these parameters are not known. So you have these n machines, but you don't know the parameters of these machines. So the one might be, you know, might have probability of giving you $1 million, but you don't really know. And the other ones, maybe they give you more continuous reward, but in average less, and so forth. So you don't know these parameters. And the problem is now, what does the agent do? On the one hand, he should choose machines to learn about them, learn whether they are promising in terms of high reward. And on the other hand, at the same time, the agent should choose machines to maximize some kind of other criteria, like the sum of rewards. So a bit more formally, we denote the choice of the machine as AT. So in iteration T, the agent chooses the machine AT, which is just an integer. When it chooses that machine, there is going to be a return, which we call YT. And that, well, it's being sampled from the distribution of that machine AT. So it has a mean, which I denote by Y, of AT. Now, here's a first interesting statement, which is obvious, but still it's important to note. So what possibly can the policy, the optimum policy, be? So what is it mapping? And the answer is that the optimum policy, well, it maps all the information that it can possibly have to a new choice of a machine. Now, what is all the possible information that the agent can have? Well, it's all the history of what it has experienced before. So an optimal policy or a strategy maps all the history of what the agent has been seen so far to a new choice. And the history here is denoted by, well, the first choice of machine and the return it got from that machine, the second choice of machine and the return it got from that, until some, you know, time step t when it then chooses a new machine. So the problem formulation could be find such a mapping that maximizes, and now there is different possibilities of how to define the objective. A typical one is that maximizes the average return in some finite horizon, or that maximizes the return that you get at a deadline at some finite horizon. So that's an interesting one. So you have like a T, big T time steps to just experiment with all the machines, and then at time big T, it's really deadline, and you have to choose a machine and maximize the return of exactly that machine in this one time slice. Or other objectives like the discounted infinite horizon, which would just sum up all of the returns discounted by some scalar small one. The bandit problem very often is being described as an archetype for formalism exploration exploitation problems. I'm going to discuss this later, whether this actually talking about exploration exploitation is such a good idea. But still, intuitively, yes, this is an issue and this is an aspect of what's happening. Choosing a machine has two effects. On the one hand, you collect more data about that machine, so you enhance your knowledge about that machine. On the other hand, you collect some reward. Exploration would mean, for instance, to choose the action to minimize. Here I wrote something which is the entropy of the belief. I will define the belief in a second. Basically, it means to maximize the information gain of your knowledge. Exploitation could be defined as choosing the next action just to maximize the return, the immediate return in the next time slice. So bandit problems could be viewed as an archetype of formalism, that kind of issue between exploration and exploitation, as we will discuss a bit more later. Now, let's move to the question, what actually is the optimal strategy? And it can not so difficult actually to write down formally what the optimal strategy would be. The first insight is that the knowledge that the agent has gained so far from interacting with machines can be represented in two ways. You can represent that knowledge as the full history that it has collected. That's, you know, obviously all the kind of information that it can have from these machines. Or it can aggregate that history actually in what is called the belief. And the belief I define here as the posterior over all latent parameters of these machines conditional to that history. Well, that's of course given by Bayes' rule. And so the belief in a Bayes optimal sense accumulates all the information that we could possibly have about the machines, because remember, theta is all the properties that these machines have. the parameters that these underlying probability distributions of the machines have. So just to give examples of what that belief might concretely be in the Bandit case. So in the Bandit case, first, the typical assumption is that these machines are independent, that their parameters are independent, and therefore also the posterior belief can be factorized into, you know, factors which just denote the belief about the parameters of the ice machine, which is multiplied. And you could now make different assumptions about these machines. For instance, machines could just return 0-1 returns. So these might be binary machines. In that case, well, the parameter of such a binary machine is just the probability of returning a 1 instead of a 0. And you, as I said in the introduction, I always assume priors. So you could start off having a prior about all of these machines. For instance, that you have a prior that this parameter is initially distributed by some beta distribution with some hyperparameters alpha and beta. And once you collected some information about the machine, that is, you get some experiences with that machine, you compute the posterior, which is again a beta. And the beta looks very simple. You just have to sort of count how often you've seen a 0 or how often you've seen a 1. These equations here just count how often you've seen a 0 or a 1 with that machine. So this is one example of a posterior belief about all the machines if they were binary. If the Bandits are Gaussian, you could do the same thing. For instance, if you would assume them Gaussian but with a constant noise, then their only parameter is the mean of the Gaussian, and you could just compute some posterior about these parameters. So the belief is sort of a sufficient aggregation of the history for an optimal position. But now, what is really the optimal policy? So the optimal policy definitely requires some type of planning. You have to plan ahead, right? To, for instance, choose actions to learn about the machines before you can later on sort of exploit that knowledge and get high reward. There is now two ways to think of that process that is actually happening. And I like just, you know, because I think it's sort of easier to view, to sort of draw these processes as graphical models. So from the outside perspective, you could say that the world has some kind of parameter theta. And that parameter is actually constant, right? So the machines do not change over time. So although here I wrote them here as random variables, so these transitions here, they're meant to be constant. They're a bit gray, that's what I meant to say. So there is some kind of constant parameter in the world, and depending on that parameter, when the agent chooses a machine, there's going to be a return, and that experiment just repeats, and so forth. Well, that is sort of an outside description of the process that is happening. From the perspective of the agent, he cannot use that graphical model to actually really or directly to sort of do inferences or, you know, compute something about the actions. So you can sort of alternatively describe the same process as what is called a belief, you know, a Markov process in belief space. And we're going to explain MDPs in detail much later, but I think here it's already okay to sort of describe what is happening from the perspective of the agent. From the perspective of the agent starts off with some belief over the machines. So depending on that belief, he chooses the machine. Depending on the machine that he chooses, and there's going to be a return. And depending on that return, he will update the belief, right? There is an interesting aspect here. Well, first a simple one. So the update of that belief here is actually, so I drew it here as a conditional probability, but the update of the belief is, of course, a deterministic update. It's just a Bayesian update. I wrote this here, so the conditional probability of the new belief, given the old belief and the new information, is just a deterministic update. And this is a little notation I use explicitly in these slides, which means it's sort of the base update of that belief with no new data. Now, the interesting thing here is that from the perspective of the agent, the outcome of that experiment is uncertain. And it's uncertain also in the sense that from the perspective of the agent, the best possible estimate of what the outcome will be sort of integrates over that belief. So here, the conditional probability of that y is given a choice and the current belief is just integrating over the current belief state. The point is the optimal policy of that belief MDP is really also the optimal policy in that process up there. It really is, because that describes what optimally the agent could know and could optimally do. And that's very good to know, good to understand, because, well, that's a graphical model. And if you look at that graphical model, you see that the belief here are separators in that Markov process. And if you know about inference in graphical models or any kind of computation or inferences in graphical models, you know that, well, basically it will amount to propagating information about these separators. And in the specific case that we're talking about, this will end up to do dynamic programming. And what we have to actually propagate is what is called a value function, depending on this separator of that Markov process. So the value function is being defined as whenever you're in a belief, that belief, depending on that belief, you can determine what is the best possible return that you can receive in the whole future. And this is what the value function is defined as the best possible return you can get in the future. Oh, this should be a T here. We should start from T. As is clear from these kinds of computations on chains and Markov processes, you can write down an iterative equation for that, saying that, the best possible return in that belief can be expressed as, some function of the best possible return in that belief. So you can do dynamic programming, the basic Bellman principle, right? And compute optimal value functions from that. Which means that what we learned is that an agent can behave optimally in a bandit setting by computing value functions over belief. That's cool because, think about it, what it means. The agent computes value functions, and thereby assigns a value that is, the maximal achievable return depending on its current state of knowledge. The optimal policy is greedy with respect to that value function. But the interesting thing is that if you think about that, it means that the agent actually now is doing some kind of planning in its own belief space. Is there a question over there? Oh. Yeah, so he's asking, are we guaranteed that this will not diverge? Was that the question? So if the returns, are bounded by something, and because this is even a finite horizon in that case, it definitely will not diverge. If you would have the infinite discounted case, then the gamma would have to be smaller 1, and it would also not diverge. Is there anything? So the solution is basically some kind of planning in the belief space. And let me just assume you don't know much about planning, or even in robotics, there's all these path planning kind of methods that you know about, which are very closely related to actually propagating value functions in dynamic programming. So this is what is happening here. The agent actually really navigates and sort of plans a path through its own state of knowledge, right? And that's the whole, powerful idea that is behind all of these problems. So this navigation through its own state of knowledge, this is what will end up to be optimal and will end up to sort of automatically involve types of some kind of actions that will explore, some kind of actions that will exploit. So it will automatically decide, whether it wants to choose an action in order to learn something and sort of reduce the entropy of its belief space, or whether it wants to exploit something to get some kind of return and so forth. So this is the fundamental idea that we can learn from formulating the optimal solution like that. Right, the optimal policy is greedy with respect to that value function. I'm going to come back to that again. That's an interesting thing, of course. And computationally, it is true that this is quite heavy. So, because the belief is a probability distribution, right? So we want to navigate through the space of probability distributions. The value function is a function over that space, and computing these value functions, seems quite heavy initially. I skipped that comment here. It's related to the Gittins index, but I skipped that here. But just to make this a bit more explicit, this is like an example exercise. Actually, I never really gave this to students to solve, but you're happy to try, and I hope it will work out. I didn't try myself. But when preparing the slides, I thought it would make sense to sort of include what could I, you know, what kind of exercise could I give about that. I think this would be feasible. One could consider a case where there is a 3 binary bandits, and for a you know, moderate horizon, t equals 10. And well, because they're binary, we know that the belief can be represented by beta distributions. So we have 3 beta distributions for each of these bandits. And each of these beta distributions is sort of represented by the counts of that we have in these beta distributions. So in total, because we have 3 bandits and 3 beta distributions, these are 6 integers to represent the belief. It's not so bad. And all of these integers, because t is limited to horizon 10, all of these integers should be smaller than 10, right? So the whole belief space is actually, I mean, it is large, but not so large. It's actually, you know, this these numbers from 0 to 10 to the 6, which is a million different belief states that could possibly be visited in that whole process. And you would have to compute the value function over that space. In fact, many of these states are not possible to be visited, but for the exercise, you can neglect this. And also doing it that way, it's not really the most efficient way to solve, to compute the optimal policy in bandits, because there's other methods like the Gittins index. But, oh well, who cares? At least this would be an exercise which I think would be doable, and you could really compute the optimal policy for these 3 binary bandits, assuming that you have some prior over these bandits. So the exercise would just be computing actually the value function over that over these million points, and get the policy, which is, you know, sort of an arg max type of expression of that value function, and then compare it with other kinds of heuristics. So I think in some, you know, small cases, actually computing optimal policies certainly is possible for bandits. And that's the point of that exercise. Now I already mentioned, you know, comparing to something else in UCB. Throughout this lecture, when I go through these different topics, I will always first describe what would be the optimal policy. But it turns out that the literature about all of these methods actually rarely focuses on computing the optimal policy, because it's so heavy to actually compute the optimal policy. And that's why when you look into tutorials about bandits, actually, usually it's never even mentioned that you could compute the optimal policy, at least in those that I looked. Instead, the whole literature and also the usually textbooks on bandits and these other kinds of problems, they directly focus on heuristics. And well, so let me just start with one which is maybe the most central one in the case of bandits, which is called the upper confidence bound. So instead of computing the optimal policy, what you could do is just, you know, use this recipe here. Let me go through that recipe. So if you have n machines, you could just play each machine at least once. I mean, why? Because just get at least one data point for each machine. Otherwise, I don't know. You cannot have any estimate of that machine at all. After you've played each machine at least once, you can repeat, well, play the machine that maximizes this expression here. And this expression is quite simple. So the y hat is the average reward that you have experienced from that machine I. And then there is some quantity here, which let me neglect the log up here first, which goes with 1 over ni, 1 over square root ni. So 1 over square root ni, that's maybe if you know about Gaussians or so, if the bandit would be Gaussian, that 1 over square root ni is of course related to the standard deviation of your mean estimator. And at least here, this quantity scales with this kind of, if it was Gaussian and the standard deviation, and there is this additional log n. So the n here is actually the total number of rounds that you had so far, so I could call this t as well. Now, the reason that this log n is actually in here, I don't go into detail, you'll find it here, so that's one of these heavy theoretical analysis, that it's a good idea to have this here. If you not have some prior knowledge about what actually the machines are. So even if the machine would not be binary or would not be Gaussian, if you put this log n here, there's still theoretical strong guarantees that there will be a bounded regret, so a bounded suboptimality if you choose that rule. If the machines are Gaussian, or if they would be binary, you could actually replace that term here by something which is more optimal, which is exactly these kind of quantiles that you would get from a beta or from a Gaussian. So what does the UCP do? In a sense, the UCP determines a confidence interval for what the average return, the average return of that machine. So that the average return of that machine is within some interval. And I called the size of this interval, I called it now sigma instead of this square root of something. And you want to choose that interval, the size of that interval that is the sigma, such that it is within that interval with a certain high but fixed probability. So you fix sort of quantiles for that. And what the UCP basically does is what is called a sub-optimism in the face of uncertainty. So what it does, it sort of associates a kind of return or payoff to a machine which is the upper boundary of that confidence interval, which is like you're being optimistic and saying, well, I'm so uncertain about the mean value, maybe the mean value is higher than my current estimate, and it's higher exactly by one of these confidence bounds intervals, and this is an optimistic assumption, and so this is what you associate to that machine. The interesting thing is, which I do not go into detail, is that in fact, using UCB, you can derive strong bounds on the regret that is on the suboptimality, or the suboptimality measured in terms of the reward you did not collect, although you could have collected if you would have done it optimally, which is, the citations are in the slides later, which is, for instance, given in a paper of our. Right. So let me just here already mention some literature to go into more depth. Because in this tutorial I want to sort of draw connections between all these fields, I will not go into further depths of all of these things, but instead give you a whole lot of references of where you might learn more about them. So there was a really good tutorial on bandits again at ICML. There's going to be lots of ICML tutorials cited in that one. A really, I think, important paper by Auer and other people was exactly about this analysis of the bounded regret in the case of UCB in a multi-arm bandits. In a more classical paper, well, actually not the classical paper, but still a classical paper which discusses even more classical older papers, is the one by Weber, which more, in more traditional terms talks about the Gittins index. And yeah, which is actually related to the value function. So, what is the conclusions of that first part? I draw here some conclusions just to prepare actually the discussion of these other topics that I wanted to come over. So the bandit problem is an archetype for problems that involve sequential decision making, where decisions actually influence the knowledge as well as the rewards, or later on also states. And sometimes it's been called as an archetype problem for understanding the trade-off between exploration and exploitation. All of these aspects will exactly be inherent in also the problems of global optimization, active learning, and reinforcement learning, as we will see. And the two main points is that we understood that you can solve these problems by navigating through belief space, by belief planning. You can solve these problems optimally in that way, but very often, that's computationally heavy, and what people instead do is they invent some kind of greedy heuristics like the UCB, which in that case even has guarantees about the regret. Right. So, following up, I will talk about global optimization, active learning, and also Bayesian reinforcement learning, and try to formulate them in a way to sort of match it as best as possible to what we just learned about bandits, and sort of see that using the same methods we can talk about optimal global optimization and optimal active learning and so forth. So global optimization is usually introduced as the problem that we are in some search space, and this might be in n-dimensional continuous space. And over that search space, you have some real valued function defined, f. And, well, very often it's just specified roughly as, well, we want to find the minimum of that function. I could also talk about constraint problems. So actually, all the framework, all the things that I talk about, one could include constraints, inequality constraints, and equality constraints if one would like, but I sort of neglect this here. Under global optimization, usually one refers to the problem of black box optimization, meaning that we want to find this optimum of the function only, and the agent is only allowed to sample values of that function. That is, the agent is not allowed to sort of access the gradient or the Hessian of that function, right? And in general, we might also assume that the observations may be noisy in that case. So, generally, it is, you know, the problem is always formulated as you want to find the minimum of that function, but we can make this or define this a bit more clear of what actually might be an objective for a good optimization algorithm. So, in a sense, you could say that global optimization is a case of having infinite many Bennets. That's something one should really understand, but it's simple to understand. So, in the sense, global optimization is the same thing. You are in a high-dimensional search space. You pick a point, and you get a return from that point. And you pick another point, you get a return from that point. It's like picking a machine, you get a return. But the issue is, well, now I have infinitely many points that I can pick. So actually, it's like having infinitely many Bennets that I can sort of pull the lever. So picking a search point XT is like pulling a lever of machine, but now we have infinitely many machines. So this function, which is not known, is like what we had the theta. It's the properties of these machines. And this function over the continuous space defines a return or reward for every continuous point in that space. So instead of having a finite number of actions of choosing one machine, you now have like a continuous infinite many actions in that continuous n-dimensional space of picking a point and getting a return, right? If you put it that way, global optimization is a problem of infinite Bennets. And instead of just saying find the minimum, we make this a bit more concise and say, please find a policy which is optimal. And optimal means it maps all the information that it can possibly have, and all the information it can possibly have is the whole history of experiences it had so far, all the points and outcomes that it had so far, to a new search point such that it minimizes the average return that it got until some finite horizon, or interestingly also it minimizes the final value of the function that you want to optimize. At some time horizon t. Again, that's some really interesting problem if you think about it. So the problem is you're given big t time steps, say 20, right? And you have some high-dimensional function, you're given 20 time steps. You're allowed to do whatever you like, sample the function here and here and here and here. And all that matters is that in the 20th iteration, please pick the point which minimizes the function as best as possible. This is what it says here, right? Which is an interesting problem. You had a question here? So this function is a scalar function. We have a scalar function over cost space. Let me just put it here. And so maybe let me explain what is that expectation here. So the expectation here is about over all the history that has been generated by policy. So when you fix a policy, there is some generative process which defines a probability distribution over history or sequence of point outcome, point outcome, point outcome. This is what this expectation has been taken over. And well, this is scalar function, so you want to minimize that scalar function. What's the question? You minimize with respect to what? That's the policy. Yeah, so find a policy such that I should put min in the policy below, if you mean that. I see. Right. Same thing again. yes, the optimal strategy can only be such that it maps all the information you can possibly have to a new search point. And you could encode all the information that it can possibly have as the history that it's collected so far, or you can aggregate it in a belief, again, in the innovation sense. So to make the analogy to the bandits more, you know, more obvious, the unknown properties of the world now is not the parameters of the bandits, of the machines, but now it is actually the function itself, the function f, which we don't know, which, you know, this parameter we called a theta before. We want to formulate, or we want to compute a belief over these unknown properties of the world. So if we have a Gaussian process prior over that function, and we have a history, or now I call it the data set, we can, of course, compute the belief over the properties of the world, that is, the belief over that function. One statement, actually, here. Perhaps you notice that in the bandits case, we typically choose priors which assume that the bandits are independent. That would be daunting if we do that in a continuous space, right? If you think that there's infinitely many independent bandits, you're lost, right? So, of course, what people instead do is they assume that these bandits are actually dependent and correlated. Well, they're exactly correlated as they are, you know, in the Gaussian sense, as Gaussian processes describe them. So actually, this prior assumes that these infinite bandits are correlated, and only then it makes sense to actually, you know, try doing something. So when we have this the GP prior over our unknown parameter, which is the function, we can compute the posterior belief over that function just with the data. And just to remind you, I'm sure you've seen this in 1,000 tutorials, this is then the mean of a Gaussian process, and this is the variance of the Gaussian process. In the context of optimization, very often the mean they call the response surface, and this variance they call the confidence intervals. Also, because in many textbooks or also notations of other people's, it's sort of hidden. Please remind to sort of distinguish between the variance of the function as you know, value, and the variance of the observation. So in the function view of GPs, you know, you can compute the variance of that function itself, and then if you add the noise, then this is actually the variance of the observation. And some people sort of hide this in the definition of the kernel, which is confusing. So here it's really the variance of the function that we're interested in, not the observation. Okay. So what is optimal optimization? We can write it down, which, you know, is interesting. As for bandits, it's just true that we can write down this process that an optimizer is being faced with exactly as a belief, MDP, and we can compute a value associated to every belief. So, and this value function is, again, as with bandits, defined like this. Again, this should be a T here. And there is a recursive equation allowing us to use, you know, Bellman iterates to actually, in principle, compute the value associated to every belief, that is, to every Gaussian process belief. That value function is of course, a function over the space of GPs. You know, it's a function over that belief, and the belief is a GP. But if we could actually compute that function, we could optimally optimize, which is interesting, right? I mean, think about that, the optimal optimizer. So conceptually, I find this just important for people to know that this exists. But even for this lecture, I thought of what would be the most minimalistic, smallest kind of problem that I could think of where this would actually be feasible. And I could not really, like, think of any case where this would be feasible, because, well, how do you handle functions over GP? Right, so again, what the whole literature, therefore, for that reason, actually focuses on in global optimization is instead using heuristics. And quite similar as in the bandit case, these heuristics, they just look basically one step ahead. So just to let you know, what are the heuristics in global optimization? I guess it's interesting to know. One heuristic is to sort of look at the probability of improvement. So when you have a current GP estimate of your function, this little plot here is actually taken from a typical reference, Jones 2001, which doesn't really look like you're used to from books like Bishop or so forth. I think your eyes are more used to these kinds of plots, right? Where there is a GP, so you have a current estimate of the GP, and there is these standard deviations. And so in every in every slice here, for every x point, so for every point x, if you slice through here, there's actually a Gaussian distribution. Here, a Gaussian distribution over values of that function of f. Jones is a bit older, that paper, and he draws this a bit different. So this is the mean estimate of the GP and the variances he draws down here. And if you would slice through here, you would get a Gaussian over the potential function values here. So for every x, you can slice through this and get a Gaussian over the potential function values. You can compute the probability of improvement. What does that mean? If you have already found a point or function value, which is y star with that value, you can sort of check if you would choose another point x, what would be the probability that the function value at this point x, which is Gaussian distributed about around the mean with a variance, what would be the probability that this value would be smaller than what you have found so far? Just the probability of improvement. Or you could compute something like the expected improvement. So what is the estimate of improvement? So the amount of improvement, taking here the difference, that you could expect when you select the point x. Or again, you could just use USB, sort of asking or is being optimistic and saying, well, if I sample at a point x, I could be optimistic and hope that there might be an outcome which is my current mean estimate plus some confidence bound. Very often, actually, in practice, this confidence bound is being selected by people by just adding the standard deviation here, so having a parameter beta here. But just to let you know, setting beta equal to 1 is not really the best thing to do. So just adding only the standard deviation is, in general, not really the best thing to do. And there is really nice theory which, you know, tells you what is a better choice, which is that paper by Srinivas and also Andreas Krause, who gave a talk here. And from that paper, I'm going to just cite some kind of examples. To give examples. So in that paper of Srinivas, they considered exactly that case of global optimization using GP priors and GP posterior beliefs and using UCB to sort of select points. What it means, again, as I said, using UCB is that you have the mean current mean estimate and you sort of add some kind of confidence interval there with some maybe beta not equal one. And then you pick the point where the mean plus the confidence interval is highest. So this is the point here, because this is a bit higher than here and higher than here. Or if this would be a sort of the GP, then you would pick the point here because this is higher than here. And with this, they sort of solve some sensor network placement problem. Also, as I skim over that slide really quickly, so what do they show in the paper? That it works better. Like all the others, like in every paper. Interestingly, in that paper, they do not compare to optimal optimization. I mean, of course, how should they, right? Because it wouldn't be really feasible. But still, I'd be very interested. It's not feasible, but I'd be really, really interested if optimal optimization could sort of be even a bit better. Maybe it could not. I don't know. I actually do not know. But maybe it could not. I'd be interested in what you think, whether the optimal optimization would be optimizing really even much faster or actually not. Hard to tell. Okay. So further reading. Again, as I said, I'm skimming over these to sort of show connections, but then if you want to go into depth, there's a lot to read in terms of global optimization. So classically, such kind of methods are called kriging. And they have actually initially been invented to find gold, I think. What do you do if there is like all of America? It's like a two-dimensional continuous search space. And then you want to find some kind of gold. I'm oversimplifying, right? And then you want to find some kind of gold and you assume that the probability of finding gold can be described by a GP classifier, let's say. So you have to sort of sample at some point, and then you find gold or not, and so forth. And you want to estimate the probability of finding gold at some other kind of place. In the very, very early of the last century, or beginning of last century, they actually invented Gaussian processes for that and called it kriging. So classically, actually, these methods are really called kriging. And so classical literature, I collected these here. There might be a bias in some sense, but yeah. So this one is one by Jones, and this is also by Jones, who wrote these kind of things like global optimization for expensive black box algorithms. So why does he say expensive? Because he says, well, you're allowed to use a lot of computation to optimize the next point that you want to search to. Because every sample that you take from the function is really expensive, like drilling a hole in the earth or so, right? And then it really makes sense to spend a lot of computation just to optimize the next sample that you take. And here's also a paper talking about taxonomies and so forth. I think really a more modern presentation of that issue is, and a really nice one is actually by that paper that I already mentioned. I quite like that paper, and it's more sort of consistent to how I presented the thing here. Next one, active learning. Let me introduce active learning. I think optimization, everybody sort of knew what optimization is, right? Active learning, perhaps people don't know so intuitively what it is. So I tell you the intuitive story, which is actually questionable then if we as we will see later. So the intuitive story would be that in typical machine learning, well, you have a fixed data set, so you have a data set of labeled things, or labeled images in that case, and this is a classification problem. Fixed data set, and you give that data set to some kind of machine learning method, a classifier, don't know why they draw here some kind of network, don't know. They use a GP classifier, actually, in that paper. And then, well, the classifier has been trained on the fixed data set, and that's it. And then you can sort of test it maybe on test data. Now, in active learning, what happens is there is sort of an iterative process of learning, which is interesting. So you start off with only very few labeled data. You train your model on that labeled data, and then that model sort of intuitively does some kind of introspection. It sort of says, okay, now I had some data, but actually, if I would test myself on some kind of new image, on some kind of test image, my uncertainty on that test image would be very high. So the machine learning agent here, in a sense, does some kind of introspection and sort of asks, well, what are actually the test points, the test images, which you can, for instance, take from some unlabeled data set, for which the classifier would be very uncertain about the classification. That's an interesting thing to know. So the classifier then says, well, actually, so this image right here, I would have no idea what the label would be for that. So the classifier gives this to human and says, please label that for me, because I think if you label that image for me and put it in the label data set, that will be great information for me to sort of become better in the next iteration. So the classifier gives like an unlabeled image to the human, says, please classify for me. The human classifies it, puts it into the label data. Then the classifier trains again, and then again proposes another unlabeled image, please being labeled by the human, and then the human labels it, and so forth. The idea is that this process of learning is much more efficient than just having a batch data set. And also in practice, I find this very, very compelling, right? Because, the machine learning method really tries to be, I don't know, not ask stupid questions to the human, but actually ask intelligent questions. So asking intelligent questions means asking questions about labels of images, which it is really uncertain about, and which, seemingly, the current information it had did not give any information about. So that's the intuitive idea of active learning. So to put this, again, a bit more formal, so standard machine learning, you have a batch data set. It's given, and you just learn of that from that. In active learning, it's an iterative process, and a learning agent sequentially decides on a new input, so a test input. It could be an image, and sort of gives this input to an oracle or a human to label it and thereby collect new data. Well, so generally, just on the intuitive level, of course, the aim of that whole procedure should be that the learner chooses these new these data points that it wants labeled in a way that the learner learns as fast as possible about the whole problem. So generally, you could think that the learner wants to choose data points to minimize its predictive error. So let me try to formalize this a bit more. So you could think again of a finite horizon problem. This is a bit like a finite budget thing. It's like the T could be the patience of the human, right? The human only has patience to label 20 images or 200, don't know. So it's a finite horizon thing. And again, so what is the policy of that active learning agent? Well, again, the policy, the optimal policy necessarily, can only map all that it knows so far. And well, all that it knows so far is encoded in all the data that it has collected so far onto a new query point. So the policy is such a mapping, and what would be an objective function to optimize that policy? Again, this would be like a minimizing with respect to the policy. This is an objective, and let's go through through this in detail. So what is written here is the necklock likelihood of a test data point. And I wrote here explicitly what we take the expectation over. So first, the necklock likelihood, I hope you all know, is like an error, right? If this would be a Gaussian predictor, necklock likelihood is squared error. So this is just necklock likelihood is an error. We take the expectation over a test data point. So what expectation is that? The X is being selected, you know, randomly or by some test distribution from the input space. And the Y is actually, you know, a sample from the real world. So both of these are actually samples from the real world. We take the expectation over that. And also we take the expectation because the evolution of the whole process, so the active learning in itself, is a stochastic process. We take the expectation over the data that the agent may collect if it follows a certain strategy. So this is it, and what it means is please find a strategy such that at the deadline, when the human is sort of bored and doesn't want to answer anything anymore, after that, please, your model should have minimal error, maximal, yeah? I assume that it knows the distribution of X star, yes. As will be important in the next lines. Right, so this is what we want to minimize. Again, in a sense, the agent cannot minimize this or exactly evaluate this exactly. Why? Because it cannot take a sample from the, you know, this test distribution. It doesn't know the test distribution. A bit like we had this transition from the description of the process directly knowing the thetas to the belief Markov decision process. What the agent can evaluate, or what the problem is from the perspective of the agent, is that it can sort of evaluate that necklock likelihood, its own error, using its own Bayesian belief, right? Because its own Bayesian belief of the function is the best possible estimate of that function. So it can sort of evaluate that necklock likelihood, not with respect to a true test data point, but with respect to its own you know, Bayesian belief. If it does that, then, well, the expectation over the necklock likelihood can be written like that. You take the expectation over the Y star using its own Bayesian belief over the function. And then this is, again, the log likelihood. Here's the neck. And this then turns out to be an expectation over the entropy over all its predictions at any point. And again, here, exactly, we assume that we have the distribution over X star. What's the question? For each and every X star, yes. Yeah? Yeah? Let's see that later, right? Okay. And again, you know, the problem would be finding a policy that, you know, minimizes that. So I just wrote this here again. Again, I think it's just instructive, even if it will be not feasible, to ask what is the optimal active learner? And, well, same thing again. So instead of having a policy that maps all the history to a new sample point, you can let the policy map the belief onto a new sample point. So now all the unknown properties of the world is, again, the function that you were interested in, say, the discriminative function of the images. And we can use a GP process to represent the belief over that discriminative function. And we'll just use a GP, it's obvious. And again, well, really the only difference to global optimization is that the reward is now different. So in global optimization, the reward was just the return Y. And in active learning, the reward that you get, say, at the final time step is just, you know, this quantity here, which you can also compute. And therefore, you know, the same things hold. If you would write down the process, it would be a Markov process over the belief. You can do dynamic programming to compute values for every belief. You can initialize the value of a final belief, which is just the entropy of your final Gaussian process after the t data points. And you could propagate back and get you know, optimal value functions for every possible belief. And the optimal policy would be the argmax here. Doing the argmax here perhaps would have to, you know, I don't know how you do it. Maybe you could try to optimize it again with an optimal optimizer. Or you could just, I don't know, sample many, many possible points. I have just a set of unlabeled data. But again, this would require to compute value functions over GP, which is just computationally really untractable. So what are the greedy one-step heuristics? Well, the simplest really greedy policy is, now it's actually different to how it was in global optimization and Banitz. It's just a one-step dynamic programming which directly maximizes immediate reward. So remember that by reward we meant the entropy of the belief. And the typical, in the literature, the typical heuristic done for active learning is to have a policy which maps your current belief, the GP, onto choosing a point that in the next time step, so without planning ahead, just one time step, minimizes the entropy of your belief. So it's like it's not a very long planning through the belief space, it just plans one step ahead in a sense and directly chooses a point that minimizes the expected entropy in the next time step. Some comments on that, which is actually interesting. If you think about that for GPs, in the case of GPs, the way you reduce the entropy of your GP most, sort of obvious, is to choose an X where the current variance of your predict is highest. Now, if you look into that, and I just copied here again the equation for the variance of your predictor, of variance of that, of your estimate of that function. If you look at that, and well, the first you realize is that this whole quantity is totally independent of all observations. So which means you can compute an optimal sequence of active learning points, totally independent of observations. That's interesting here. The order of the data point also doesn't matter. So in a sense, it means you can sort of pre-optimize a set of grid points for that kernel because the whole thing only depends on the kernel. And then play them in any order. So in that sense, actually, you know, if you follow that path, well, in a sense, it becomes not very, very much anymore a problem of planning. That's the one thing. And the other thing is that actually you could sort of pre-compute all these points and do not view it very much as a sequential process. Also for the sake of time, because I want to see the relations to other things, I stop here going into further depth and just refer, there's a really nice literature survey, active learning. Well, it's just listing a whole lot of references really and discussing them, which is very useful. There's a very, I don't know, a seminal paper, which is always being cited, which I find very instructive. And then again, there's an ISML tutorial, which is very, very nice, actually, in active learning, but almost totally complementary to what I described. So if you look into there, you will hardly understand what I talked about here. That's good. So please read also the other one, the tutorial. Okay. Now, finally, Bayesian reinforcement learning. And that's maybe the... a major part of that lecture, because all of the other things can be viewed as cases of Bayesian reinforcement learning. So let me first introduce Markov decision processes. I don't know, you did not have lectures on reinforcement learning, I guess, right? Tomorrow, Peter will talk a bit about model-free reinforcement learning. Here, we'll talk a bit about model-based reinforcement learning. But well, the general problem setting is not so hard to explain. And so the first thing is that in reinforcement learning, typically, people assume that the world is a Markov decision process. So let me just describe what is a Markov decision process. it's very similar to what we had anyway already. So a Markov decision process is you assume that the world has a state. Could be your own location or whatever. The world has some state. And typically, dependent on that state, the agent is allowed to choose an action. And depending on what action the agent chooses, the world will transition to a new state. For instance, you could be at some location, the agent chooses to walk up, and then it's at another location one step up with some probability, or ran into a wall, or whatever it did. Also, in Markov decision processes, typically they're associated with reward, which means there's different conventions. In my convention, depending on the state, you get a reward. Sometimes also, because you might want to penalize certain actions or so, you can make the reward also depending on the action. So I just generally assume that the reward is random variable depending on state and action in a time slice. So such a Markov decision process just iterates on, and is defined, I assume, stationarity, so that in every time slice there's the same condition probability tables describing these dependencies. So it can be defined by initial state distribution, by transition probability, and by reward probability. And the agent's policy here, at least in this graphical model, is also denoted as a condition probability. Now, if you know the world, and this is different to, so in the bandit case, we did not know the parameters of the bandits. In the optimization case, we did not know the function. Here, for a moment, if you just assume you know actually the world, you know all these conditional probability tables, and if you know exactly, you have an exact model of your world, then what is called planning, so planning in such an MDP means, given knowledge of all these transition probabilities, find a policy that maps actually only the state, so directly that state here, to an action, such that it minimizes here. I mean, I could also write down the finite horizon thing, but typically the discounted infinite horizon return, which is just the sum of returns, the sum of rewards discounted by some number smaller than one. And as is well known, Bellman, dynamic programming, and so forth, the way to solve this is to compute a value function of the state of that world, and to sort of iterate that backward exactly as we had. So don't go into that. So this is planning if you know the Markov decision process. Now, the word reinforcement learning doesn't refer to that, what I just explained. The word reinforcement learning typically means that the agent does not know the world, right? Solving Markov decision processes is one thing. Reinforcement learning means, well, the agent does not know the world. So it cannot use that Markov decision process to compute its optimal policy. Just in terms of notation, let's just notate this unknown parameters of the world as theta again. So in the case of bandits, the theta was all the unknown parameters of the machines. In the case of the optimization, the unknown parameters was the function that we optimize here. The unknown parameters of the world is all the parameters of these conditional probability tables. So the parameters that define the initial state distribution, the parameters that define transition probabilities, and parameters that define the reward probabilities. All of that is unknown. Now, there is two ways to go about reinforcement learning. One is called model-free, and one is called model-based. And keep this really short. Model-free, Peter is going to talk a bit more about that. Model-free reinforcement learning would mean that the agent doesn't even try to estimate these parameters theta from its data. It thinks it's too complicated to do that in a sense, and instead does other things. It, for instance, tries to directly estimate value functions, Q functions, or it leads to things like temporal difference learning, Q learning, policy gradients, whatever. I'm not going to say more about that. In model-based reinforcement learning, the agent tries to compute estimates of the world. So it collects data from the world, and from that it can estimate the unknown parameters of that world. Once it has estimated parameters of the unknown world, now the simple strategies, they then can use these parameters to do dynamic programming, and with the current estimate of the world, decide on optimal actions, or it can explore, that means sometimes choose random actions. Now, Bayesian reinforcement learning refers to the issue where you accumulate belief over your whole world. That is, you accumulate a belief over the parameters of the world, and sort of try to find optimal policies given that. So again, knowledge for the agent can be represented in two ways, either as the full history that certainly encodes all information that an agent could have to decide an action, or the belief. The belief is overall parameters of that world. That's a typo here, should be the other thing. In the case of a discrete Markov decision processes, the parameters are conditional probability tables. You could have a prior over these conditional probabilities using Dirichlet priors. And the exact posterior is then, of course, also a Dirichlet. So maintaining the belief amounts to nothing than just counting transitions, basically, right? Right, so what is optimal reinforcement learning? And again, when I now say optimal, I mean base optimal. So where we assume we have a prior over the world, over the world parameters. Again, you can represent that process that's happening in two ways. So from outside, you could say, well, the world has some properties, theta. They're actually constant. So actually, these are like constant transitions here. But I just copied them for the sake. Depending on these constant properties of the world, the agent starts in a state, and depending on the choice of its action, that's actually a decision variable. I didn't distinguish this properly. Depending on the action it chooses, there's going to transition in a new world state, depending on the properties of the world. Well, that's sort of an outside view, but again, the inside view for the agent is to formulate a belief MDP, which is the thing down here. So, because the agent doesn't have access to the true parameters, but what it has access to is the optimal Bayesian estimate of these parameters, which is called a belief. So, in that thinking, the agent can formulate internally a Markov process in terms of that belief. So, from the perspective of the agent, well, it is currently in a state S. We may assume that it observes that state. And it has currently a belief over all the parameters, the properties of the world. Depending on these two things, it chooses an action. Now, depending on that action, there is a transition in a new world state. Again, but it doesn't know the exact world properties, so it cannot know exactly this transition probability, but it can have a base optimal estimation of that transition probability, which is given here. So the transition probability to the new state is now averaging over the belief. It's averaging over all worlds that it has. So transition probability given a current belief of the agent is just the average here. This is the belief update. So given it chooses an action, it observed a certain state transition. It had an old belief over the world. It can compute a new belief over the world. And this computing the new belief is just a base update, which is a deterministic update. Yeah? Well, that's exactly the tricky thing. So here you would say the world doesn't care what the belief, what the agent believes or so, right? There's just a state transition probability in the true world. This is what this Markov process up here is supposed to describe. Well, but from the perspective that I was trying to, a belief MDP is describing the process from the perspective of the agent and from the perspective of all the information that is potentially there. And in that case, the only estimate the agent could have about the transition probability is using its own belief and integrating over its own belief. And this is the belief that it had before, and this is why, this conditional probability variable depends on all these three things, right? And, that's by definition the belief MDP. I agree. I mean, at first sight, these are two different processes. It's not really clear, but you can prove if you actually compute optimal policies within that belief MDP, they're also optimal in the true world sense, right? Which also makes sense because this is just all the information that the agent could have to estimate its own return and value. Right, so on the belief MDP, again, if you look at that graphical model, the separators in the graphical model now are S and B. So if you would do inference, junction theory, or whatever, these are the separators. And this also implies for dynamic programming in Bellman that now you can propagate value functions over these separators, which now is S and B. And you can propagate them back, and dynamic programming would yield you the optimal reinforcement learning, right? I mean, which is a very general statement, right? This is optimal behavior of an agent in a world which the agent doesn't know which world he lives in. That's a strong statement, right? But you can at least on paper write down what it is. Of course, this is computationally very heavy to compute, but there is really interesting work on this. I like the paper, which is cited later by Popar very much, which describes that that dynamic programming can actually be done, approximately. Now, here are interesting cross-relations, I find interesting. In all of these cases, I described the problem, told you what would be optimal, very often being infeasible, and then told about the heuristics that people actually do research on. And now, interesting question, are the heuristics that people in reinforcement learning talk about, are they similar, related to heuristics that people talk in bandits and so forth? I cannot say yes or no in that case, but I find it interesting to just present them next to each other. So, what are heuristics that people actually use in reinforcement learning to avoid that horrible belief planning problem? I think, and this is, I just presented here for this lecture like that, I think essentially they do very similar things as UCB does for bandits and so forth. In a sense, they choose estimates for the unknown properties of the world, which is theta, like the transition probabilities, and they choose estimates which are over-optimistic. So what does over-optimistic mean? So they assume things about the reward probabilities or things about transition probabilities which are over-optimistic in the sense that if you use these over-optimistic estimates of reward probabilities and transition probabilities, you will end up computing value functions of which the value is actually always higher than it would truly be if you would just use the current mean estimates of reward and transition probabilities. So it's using over-optimistic estimates of transition rewards and transition probabilities. And how does it do that? So there is one algorithm which is very interesting called RMAX. It chooses the reward estimate to be large. And large means larger than any reward for any other state. Here you have to assume that you know that rewards for normal states are bounded by some RMAX. So it chooses the reward function very optimistic to be sort of maximal for all the states that it has not visited so far, very often. So for all the states and state action pairs actually, which it has not visited more than n times, it's very optimistic and saying these states, I believe there is a gold pot there, I want to go there. That of course makes sense, it wants to explore these states more, right, to get better estimates. And if it has visited enough, then it just assumes that the reward is its mean estimate that it has estimated from experience. There's different ways to represent RMAX, by the way, so this is just one convention, which is not so obvious that it's equivalent to others. But anyway, so for the transition probabilities, it could assume that if in a state S and choose an action A, which it has not visited very often, it assumes that there is a deterministic transition into some special state, S star, I called it. And this, again, is the gold pot state. So by definition, actually, in that state, it always receives RMAX. So that's very optimistic. Again, if you choose an action in a state where you haven't done it very often, you sort of assume that you sort of go to heaven. And for the rest of that while, you just stay in heaven and receive a lot of reward. It's very optimistic. Whereas in other cases, which it has not visited so often, it just assumes all the mean state transition probabilities that it has so far. So that's a quite crude overestimate and very optimistic overestimate of values, if you compute values like that with these things. But the significance of that algorithm, RMAX, is very strong, actually, in theory. You can show that that there is polynomial Pack results, that after only a polynomial number, but it's a horrible polynomial, by the way. But after a polynomial number of steps, the agent can be, with high probability approximately correct. So you can define a regret, which refers to that approximation, and a probability by which you will define with which probability it will be worse than that regret, and just guarantee a polynomial Pack results. I don't go into further reading, but if you want to read about this much more, please read that paper. So all the quick literature I find really cool, actually. Quick stands for knows what it knows. And there is a really nice series of papers on knows what it knows, RMAX. It's really cool. Another heuristic, sort of similar, maybe more similar even to UCB, it's called the Bayesian exploration bonus by Coulter and Eng. Well, it sort of estimates the transition probabilities not optimistic, just, you know, as the mean estimates, or no, not the mean, actually the Bayesian estimates integrating over the current belief, but chooses the reward similar to UCB, using the mean reward that it has estimated so far, plus some confidence interval, and the confidence interval, well, is, I don't know, it's just this. I just leave it with that. And I think these are here, again, the counts, or the square root of counts, I forgot actually, of how often you've been in state S and A. Quite similar, I think, to UCB, and you can look up into the paper. And there's other heuristics, like assigning or thinking to, or trying to derive confidence intervals for the V or the Q function in more older literature by Kobling and Durden. Right, so here is a quite long list on further reading if you want to go into detail of that. And one is there's really a good tutorial on Bayesian reinforcement learning, and I like especially, so I'm pointing to one specific set of slides, the part three by Pascal Poupart, and there's a whole like a nice discussion of literature on site 22, which I just skipped of discussing here. There is a couple of, well, I don't know. There is a seminal paper, maybe, or actually a thesis, working quite a lot on these kind of formulating POM DPs and reinforcement learning as belief MDPs. Here's the paper on quick RMAX and, well, the Bayesian exploration bonus and so forth. I skipped the POM DP thing. Anyway, my POM DP part was only very short, anyway. And I only actually wanted to include it for completeness in a sense, because all of what I said could also be represented as POM DP, but it doesn't really make such, yeah? Yes, so POM DP is a partially observable Markov decision process. So far we discussed Markov decision processes and planning in Markov decision processes, and this is a partially observable Markov decision process, which basically means that the agent does not have access to the state directly, it cannot know where it is, the state, but only has uncertain observations about that. I'll skip this for the sake of time, and I think for the main points I wanted to make anyway, it doesn't make so much a difference. Or I hope. I find a bit like three slides and three points for the discussion. So a bit sort of summarizing why I thought actually this is a good collection of for lecture. So 3 points. I think there is a common ground, which I hope I sort of made clear. So what bandits, global optimization, active learning, and Bayesian reinforcement learning, and also POM DPs have in common is all of them are actually problems which involve sequential decisions. And all of them can be shown that, well, these decisions, they collect data, and with the data you can maintain a belief, and eventually they end up to be Markovian with respect to that belief. In all of these cases, the decisions sort of influence that belief, I wrote here the knowledge, as well as rewards and states. And that's an interesting thing because very often this has sort of been thought of and intuitively described as, you know, this exploration-exploitation issue. Sometimes it's called a problem or issue, I don't know. So where you don't know, should actions or decisions, should you choose them to improve your knowledge or should you choose them to improve your rewards? This is how it's sometimes even phrased. So that's a simple first point. I think these problems are actually, you know, one thing, they're really very, very similar, and one should sort of view them as one thing. A second point, which I think sometimes, it's a simple statement, but it's sort of neglected sometimes. In all of these cases, you can simply write down belief planning, and this would yield you optimal solutions. So this means that in principle, we know what optimal optimization is. Or we know what optimal active learning is, and base optimal, of course, again. And even if this might be computationally really daunting and infeasible, I think it's really important conceptually to understand that, right? For instance, if you would think about, would want to do research there, and then you see, okay, UCB is already that not good. How could I become better than UCB? Well, maybe an idea would be try to make it more like the optimal thing, right? So you could try maybe, I haven't tried this at all, but maybe there is a two-step UCB, which does UCB planning two steps ahead, or three-step UCB or something. This might be natural ideas from that perspective, knowing, understanding that optimal solutions would involve belief planning. At least this should give you ideas of, you know, doing further research and thinking about how to design better heuristics as well. And now, what is interesting conceptually is that these optimal policies, they all navigate through belief space or knowledge space. So the point I want to make here is that, in a sense, this automatically implies or combines what people tend to call exploration and exploitation. So sometimes it's people say there is this exploration-exploitation problem, or the exploration-exploitation issue or trade-off, sort of suggesting that this would be like a fundamentally unsolved problem or something. Yes, it is intuitive to talk about that, and it's good, I mean, to have this, you know, to use these intuitive words, but one should be aware it's not really an issue or problem or a trade-off or so from that perspective. In a sense, there is no need to explicitly address exploration or exploitation or decide for one against the other. In a sense, these policies that are optimal in all of these cases, they just maximize one thing, namely, they just want to be good after the deadline. They want to maximize return after the deadline T. And this alone leads to policies which necessarily will have to explore or you know, choose actions that gain information or navigate through belief. That's the better view, I think, in earlier times. So I hope I made that point clear, that it's, you know, it's I think a nicer picture to think about, that it's actually doing navigating through belief than doing exploitation. And a third point, the thing about greedy heuristics, so the greedy heuristics in all of these cases are the core topic actually of research very often. An interesting first point, the optimal policy is also greedy with respect to the value function. So it's not surprising that greedy policies can be good, right? It's actually an obvious statement. I don't know, tautology, is that the word? So of course, I mean, also optimal policies are greedy with respect to the value function, which is very hard to compute. But I mean, just that simple statement tells you, well, it's not, I mean, being greedy is not bad in itself. The only question is, are you greedy with respect to what, right? And in that view, you could say that all these greedy policy or these greedy heuristics that people research about, they sort of replace the value function with something that is simpler and more direct to compute, which does not has to be computed like using iterations or belief propagation. And typically, like, these are one-step criteria, like UCB, probability of improvement, expected improvement, and so forth. And typically, interestingly, all of these also reflect some kind of optimism in the face of uncertainty, so they overestimate basically the return. I think that's interesting, I mean, also to, you know, give ideas about maybe other heuristics or so, or let me put it like that, to actually connect to things like submodularity. I think Andreas Krause also very often says, of course, I mean, that's this whole thing, being greedy is good. I mean, if you know that the objective function is submodularity, right? You know that greedy policies only have a bounded regret and so forth. And yes, that's exactly, actually myself only understood this not so long ago. Yeah, it's exactly the point. If you know, if you figure out what you can greedy with respect to, you might end up having really good strategies. Right, so for things like UCB, there is even regret bounds, which is really interesting. Now, these optimism in the face of uncertainty in reinforcement learning actually is interesting to compare. So the Bayesian exploration bonus is related, but not really exactly like UCB or RMAX or these interval exploration methods. And again, I think it's interesting to sort of see these things side by side and maybe have ideas or be inspired by transferring, I don't know, methods that are from one era to another era and see them as one thing. And I think that's it. So thank you for your attention. Thank you very much. Questions? Oh. Yes. Yes. Are you asking why I didn't mention them? Maybe I should repeat the question, right? So he's basically asking why I did not mention Monte Carlo search tree search methods. I don't know. I mean, basically you're right. So instead of using these greedy heuristics, you could just approximate more directly that process of Bellman saturation by just sampling into the future heavily. I totally agree, and I could have included them. Right. Maybe I don't know. I think there is not really much more to see. I think. What very often happens is that these tree search methods are even combined with these heuristics, right? So actually that's a good example of combining these actually one-step heuristics with some kind of method of planning ahead, where the planning ahead is not analytic, propagating these functions, but MCMC sampled. Yes. So maybe this was just actually into you.
Is there a question in the observation lounge?
No.
Okay. In that case, okay.
More of a fun question. So online algorithms also have this flavor where you're sequentially deciding things and you want to have a deterministic policy with whatever information you have, except there you possibly have information about what the reward is for every action you do, right? So is it instructive to think of all the online algorithms with competitive bounds that we study in theory also under this framework?
I guess so. So, I mean, what kind of online algorithms exactly are you referring to? So, in a sense, all the things that I here described are online algorithms, yes. And if you could frame these online algorithms as a PomDB, which there is usually no question that you can frame it, whether it's sufficient is another way, then yes, this is of course also what all of what I talked about is about, yes.
I also have a little comment to your question about global optimization and optimality of global optimization. Since I can't quite hold myself back because you asked whether it would be possible to do global optimization optimally. We tried something like this in a JMLR paper last year, which is called entropy search, and which is not exactly, of course, optimization because, as you say, it's intractable. But instead of trying to choose points which improve the observed function values, you can actually try to optimally change the belief state about the location of the optimum. And so that gets you one step closer. We're still greedy in the belief space. Of course, you can try and be non-greedy, and that just makes things even more complicated. But it does actually end up being better than UCB. So that the plot you were asking for is in that paper.
Cool, great, interesting.